The city of Stoke-on-Trent lies in comparative obscurity, in a valley that at one time would be virtually invisible from the surrounding hilltops, smothered in a dense pall of acrid smoke from the hundreds of bottle ovens and factory chimneys in the 10-mile stretch. Adding to this mass of industrial grime was the output of the giant iron and steel works at Shelton Bar, once employing over 2,500 men. In 1978, the battle for survival was lost and the massive steelworks closed down, the site becoming the worst area of dereliction in the West Midlands. In 1980, a government grant was offered to the city to help in reclamation, and the City Council jumped at the chance of reclaiming the site in 3 years instead of the 15 years it was estimated for the job if left to their own resources, if indeed the task could ever be started. It would enable the 180-acre site to be speedily reclaimed and developed for commercial and leisure use. The key to all this was the staging of a national garden festival. The land was purchased from British Steel and the Duchy of Lancaster, and the City Council set up a team of engineers, landscape architects, and planners. There were many difficult and unique engineering problems in stabilising the large areas of slurry and deposits of debris, particularly in the early stages. The roadways had to be linked to the existing network, which again had to be enlarged to take the greater traffic flow. Landscaping on a gigantic scale was necessary, and huge loads of subsoil and peat had to be brought in to render the ground fertile once more. Many thousands of trees had to be planted as soon as possible, and large areas of the site had to be compacted and made safe for future commercial use. These areas would need main drains and all services, as well as a complete road system. Work actually began at the end of 1982. Reclamation and main foundation work was completed by the end of 1984, and the cost so far was £6.5 million. Josiah Wedgwood brought his pottery here from Burslem in 1768. Surely he would be happy to know that his Etruria garden was to bloom once again. The marina was dug out and connected to the Trent and Mersey canal system, which flanks the western boundary of the park. Permanent features on the edge of the lake were to be a public house and 20 show houses, which would later be offered for sale. The site hummed with activity as the work proceeded, and a multitude of festival buildings began to take shape. Some of these were to be permanent features. The budget of £5.3 million was quite inadequate for Joe Samworth's design. It needed at least £12 million. After much heart-searching, the estimate was pruned to £10.5 million, and this amount was in fact found, about a third from commercial sponsors and investors. British Gas and H.R. Johnson sponsored the trains which were provided by the festival and manned by them. An outside firm erected and ran the cable car system. The final appalling winter and spring slowed things down, but everything was eventually ready on time. Sunny smiles and cheers broke through the rain clouds, and hundreds of well-wishers assembled to give Her Majesty the Queen a red carpet welcome. The festival officials were presented to the Queen, Chairman Ron Southern, Director David Hancock, and Designer Joe Samworth. The Secretary of State for the Environment, Mr. Kenneth Baker, was also presented to the Queen. The Chairman of the Staffordshire County Council, Mr. Arthur Collerton, and the Lord Mayor welcomed Her Majesty to the festival. Among the audience was the former Environment Minister, Mr. Michael Heseltine, the man who gave Stoke-on-Trent the chance to stage the 1986 festival. Before many yards, Her Majesty had collected armfuls of flowers from well-wishers. In spite of the frequent rain showers, the day had been a huge success. Thank you. The Grand Palm House was a popular spot for many, especially on the cold, wet days. Regular musical entertainments took place here. There were over 70 different themed gardens, ranging from the formal Elizabethan Way to the more informal conservation gardens. Wedgwoods themselves sponsored the tent-like festival halls, and visitors were treated to an ever-changing spectacle of colour in the many flower arrangements and displays. From April to October, horticultural shows were staged here in this 3,700 square yard complex. Greenhouse 2000 was built by the City Council. It cost £1 million and was to be the future modernistic nursery for the Parks Department. It will provide all the plants and flowers used for landscaping and display in and around the city. The rocky valley gave wonderful opportunities for water cascades and a pleasant pathway through to other areas without the necessity of a stiff climb up and over the woodland ridge. For those who did climb the hill, the reward was great, and many interesting features were there to be enjoyed. A red dragon introduced us to a little piece of Wales, authentically reconstructed on the hillside. The whimsical Twyford Loo fountain display attracted much attention. There were 100 or more pieces of sculpture scattered here and there, often adding just a little touch of humour to those parts of the gardens. They provoked much discussion and comment. One member of the staff was heard to say, "If you don't know what it is, and it doesn't move, it's a sculpture." On the side of the woodland ridge, there was a market area with a large number of shopping units. Street entertainers wandered around and provided amusement for young and old. The flowerpot man was a great favourite. The air was alive with the sound of music, an ever-changing pattern. An undercover area where other musical entertainment was provided, and it was nice to sit down for a restful interlude. Victorian Glasgow Bandstand provided a platform for many visiting musicians, and local bands played there frequently. Climbing and abseiling were demonstrated by lads from the Staffordshire Regiment. And permanent play areas for younger children were kept very well attended. Planners knew the popularity of high vantage points, and they had provided a sky ride for just this purpose. This 18-gondola, French-built cable car system transported people right up to the top of the woodland ridge, climbing spectacularly via a central tower 150 feet above the ground. Up here was the Expo 86 exhibition area and a lovely garden project called The Labyrinth. Walking around this 180-acre site was a tiring business, but there was a plentiful supply of resting places and areas for refreshment. Over 80 displays of bedding plants were tended and changed through the seasons. The walled Glasgow garden was based on an age-old design. Several local authorities built gardens. The West Midlands County Council produced a fascinating industrial representation, blending with floral displays and rest areas. Thank you. There were 2.5 miles of railway track for the 3 little trains, and 5 stations were very conveniently placed round the circular route. Blackpool Tower was a popular landmark. One of the great successes of the festival was the enthusiasm of the staff with their "Have a nice day" greeting, which they really meant. 800 of them were young people, straight off the dole. 70-80% of all the comments about the festival were in praise of the staff and their attitude to the job. They were indeed real ambassadors for the city. A piece of Herefordshire looked as though it belonged here. Water played a big part in the festival. Jets, sprays, and cascades were part of every vista. One of the most spectacular displays was that of the classical Stapley Water Garden, with its fascinating multi-jetted fountain as the centrepiece. The greatest show of 1986. Was it the National Garden Festival or was it the Royal Tournament Parade? One thing is certain, on Sunday, July the 6th, we had the greatest show of the decade in the streets of the city as the world-famous Royal Tournament preview was presented for us. A grand parade of superb military marching and music. For the first time in its 106-year history, the preview parade took place outside the streets of London. Of the Household Cavalry. Field guns. The RAF police dogs with their handlers. A delightful tribal mud dancer from New Guinea. Portuguese National Guard. The RAF Queen's Colour Squadron demonstrated their superb marching skills. An 8-minute routine of 250 precise movements without a single word of command. Thank you. also filled the sky with spectacle. And the RAF Falcons added to our enjoyment with a breathtaking mass parachute jump into the packed arena area. A superb finale to a superb event, and a fitting climax to our review of the festival. What memories we will have on film and in our minds. Superb floral displays. The trains with their efficient and kindly crews. And of course, the rain, and we had plenty of that. We will remember the visit of Her Majesty the Queen and her charming manner. We will recall the men of the Royal Tournament Parade. And we will never forget the Flowerpot Man. What an achievement, from a gigantic ash tip of industrial dereliction to the now richly fertile and delightfully landscaped Festival Park, following in the tradition of its first great designer, Capability Brown, the man who planned the original garden there for Josiah Wedgwood over 200 years ago. It really is the story of ashes to roses.